Good morning, sir. We are live on YouTube. I'll just share the link in the chat box.
Okay.
Sir, can we start?
Yeah, we can start. No problem. I am comfortable.
Right, sir. Right. A very good morning to all. Myself, Narahari, Assistant Professor, Department of Pharmaceutics, Abhaypa. Welcome all of you to webinar series number 17. Neurotransmitters are endogenous chemicals which are acting as signaling molecules. Neurotransmitters are endogenous chemicals which are acting as signaling molecules that enable neurotransmission. They are a type of chemical messenger which transmits signals across a chemical synapse from one neuron to another target neuron. The release of neurotransmitter is subjected to powerful modulatory control by receptors which are located in or near presynaptic terminal. These presynaptic receptors are a diverse group of proteins, but they can be broadly divided into two classes, like metabotropic receptors and ionotropic receptors. Presynaptic receptors can functionally reshape neural circuits by rapidly and reversibly changing the properties of synaptic transmission, and the specific expression of different receptors at different synapses allows each receptor subtype to have a distinct effect on neural processing. Billions of neurotransmitter molecules work constantly to keep our brains functioning, managing everything right from our breathing to our heartbeat, to our learning, and also to our concentration levels. They can also affect a variety of psychological functions such as fear, mood, pleasure, and joy. Hence, to understand various therapeutic applications of such presynaptic regulation of neurotransmitters, Abhaypa in association with IPA have organized this webinar on presynaptic regulation of neurotransmitters therapeutic application. The resource person today is Dr. M. Ramanathan. I welcome you, sir, on behalf of Abhaypa and IPA.
Thank you.
Now, I would like to briefly give an introduction about the speaker. Dr. M. Ramanathan is working presently as a principal of PhD since Jan 2010. He graduated from Annamalai University in 1986 and started his career as a lecturer in KMR College of Pharmacy. In 1992, he cleared GATE and went to Banaras Hindu University for his master's and doctoral program from Institute of Medical Sciences. His field of specialization is pharmacology and neuroscience. In 1998, he joined in the Department of Pharmacology, JSS College of Pharmacy as assistant professor and worked up to 2005. During this period, he went for his postdoctoral program to University of Bonn, Germany, and worked in the field of neurodegenerative disorders. To his credit, he received various awards, best paper award in pharmacology session of TIPS Call 98 held at Annamalai University, Young Scientist Fellowship Award 2000 from Tamil Nadu State Council for Science and Technology, PP Suryakumari Prize for the year 2000 from Indian Pharmacological Society for the best paper published in the field of diabetes, International Brain Research Organization Fellowship for Asia Oceanic Region 2001. He also got an invitation from BMBF as guest scientist to work in the Department of Physiological Chemistry, University of Bonn, Germany. Presently, his ongoing research projects from ICMR, DST, and DBT, that total cost is above 3 crores. In November 2011, he was conferred with the Professional Excellence Award by Tamil Nadu, Dr. MGR Medical University, Chennai, to recognize his service in the development of pharmacy profession. He has guided 27 M-Pharm projects and 14 PhD students, and still guiding 5 PhD students. His total research papers comes to around 91. With his chapter in the book, there are two chapters, and then he has two patents being filed already. He has 27 national research articles, and then he has total of 45 international articles with seven proceedings that are still going on, both national and international. So now I cordially request Dr. M. Ramanathan sir to take over the session and enlighten us regarding presynaptic regulation of neurotransmitters and its therapeutic applications.
Thank you for your nice introduction. Also, I thank the organizers, Aditya Institute, for giving me an opportunity to share our experience, research experience in the field of neuroscience. So today I'll be talking on the specific regulation of neurotransmitters and its therapeutic application. I'll not go in depth, but still I want to give you the significance how these chemicals and nerve endings can be a therapeutic importance, as well as how we can really work on in these new targets. Okay, so I'm audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible, sir. You're audible.
Okay. Oh yeah, thank you. So I'll be talking about the neurons and its communication. This is a very fundamental for any communication responses across our body system. And once if you say they communicate, somebody has to regulate it. So how it can be get regulated? And if the regulations and communications goes wrong, how the disease can progress? See, in those situations, how we can intervene with the therapeutic drugs. So that will be my sequence, and which are currently existing in the pharmacological science as well as the clinical side. And next two things, which we have done a simple work in our department involving glutamate receptors and its regulation in controlling ischemic conditions. So it's a published work in the Behavioral Pharmacology in 2018. And I'll give concluding remarks for the futures, how it can be done and how it can be useful for the youngsters to carry it forward. This will be my flow of my presentation, and I'll be limit only on these. If any doubts is there, I'll ready to clarify to the audience.
Definitely, sir. We'll have a session at the end. Question answer session we'll have.
Yeah. Thank you. So first is the basic. So what is neurons and what is neurotransmitters? Since the neurons is a fundamental unit of brains, but many of us think the entire brain is completely with neuronal system. But it is only 1/3 is the neuronal brain, the neurons remaining all about the glial cells, astrocytes or oligodendrocyte type of cells, which are supportive cells to the neurons. And which have much higher function like production, immune system responses, inflammatory responses. So those things are all taken care by these supportive materials. And apart from this, we have a definite set of neurons present in the brain and which is localized in certain areas where it has its own functionality and also releases the chemicals. That is the basic of the nervous system or neuronal system in the brain. Apart from this, we have peripheral nervous system, that is autonomic nervous system, that I'm not going to discuss it here. And we have neurochemicals. So these are all endogenous substances synthesized, stored and released upon stimulation. That is very important. And every function is controlled by these neurochemicals upon nervous stimulation. And the examples of these neurotransmitters are like acetylcholine, noradrenaline, dopamine, 5-HT, that is serotonin, histamine, glutamate, gamma-aminobutyric acid, GABA, glycine. So these are all well-known neurochemical which is present in the biological system in the brain, and we also studied in pharmacology. It also present in CNS, that is in the brain, which also controls and regulates many functions of the human, including their cognitive function to the motor coordinations. Everything is controlled by these chemicals. So neurons will function with the help of chemicals, And these chemicals, if they are not present, the neurons will slowly die. And the neurons are present, definitely they'll have the chemicals which are very active. So that means we have to activate the neurons, means we need a chemical. If the chemical is not present, the neuron may go down regulations, then it might not have any significant functions in the brain system, which might lead to complications. So these two we should remember. So neurons and neurotransmitters are integrated, and without any one of that, the system will not exist. And these are all the pictures I have taken from the Fundamentals of Neurology book. And you can see here, I told about this astrocytes. This is a big astrocyte cell, which is associated with the neurons. And these astrocytes is a tissue, and it also links with our blood system. I said about the importance of secretory properties, inflammatory properties, or even if something goes wrong, these substances will secrete the chemicals, goes to the capillary system and goes to the circulation. And they have a networking with the neurons. That is also very important. You can see the synapses here with the astrocytes. And similarly, if you take the neuron, we can see an axon here. So this axon can be insulated with the myelin sheets. And for insulation purpose of myelin sheets, you can see here like a small ring type is going on. And these myelin sheets is covered with the Schwann cells. And the Schwann cells forms like an insulator to the neurons and protects the neurons from the damage, or can be used for a faster impulse transmission across the nodes of RAN wire. So it is called myelinated nerve fibers. And if it is no myelination, it is called non-myelinated nerve fibers. And similarly, if you take the oligodendrocyte cells, it is also associated with the neurons. It has also have the non-myelinated fibers. You can see here it is all linked with the oligodendrocyte cells. That means the neurons is always associated with other body, other cells, supportive cells, which is required for the normal functioning. And it's a typical structure of a neuron. Everybody knows that. But what the significance here is, so we are talking about this presynaptic control. This is a very important area where we can regulate the chemical release. Why? Because, see, for example, any neuron will have a regulation by excitatory as well as inhibitory nerve fibers. Suppose the stimulus is excitatory, and these synapses will stimulate my axon body, that is cellular body, and these impulses will propagate to the axon, through axon, and goes to the other neurons. Suppose if it's inhibitory type of terminus, that means there is no set of any activation or excitation, then that impulse also will get transmitted across the axon and goes to the next set of neurons. And as I told, it's a myelin sheets, node of RAN wire, and this is axon, the cellular body, and these are the basic dendrites. And these dendrites will always form a synapse with the next set of neurons. You can always see that the synapse, the presynaptic and postsynaptic neurons will never merge. There always a gap will be there. And this gap is known as synaptic cleft or synapse or junction. So wherever the chemical is released through the junction, it stimulates the next dendrites, goes to the cellular body, and the stimulus goes keep on going as a propagation responses. So that is the way how the neuronal network is working on. That is called neuronal firing. And this neuronal firing is dependent upon my action potential development or the development of my current across the cellular system or cell neuronal system. Depending upon my action potential, the type of impulse transmission can get differentiated. So we see here, this is a synapse, synaptic cleft, presynaptic and postsynaptic neurons. And we talk more about these in the further slides. And these are different types of functionality of the neuron. This is a sensory neurons where it takes a sense and goes to the brain. And from the brain, it goes to the muscles. This is motor neurons. This we studied in our physiology, sensory and motor neurons. Apart from this, these neurons or local neurons also will have an interneuron intersynapses where it gets propagated. And also it can become act like a through the neuroendocrine, like hypothalamus, pituitary system, where we have hypothalamus projections goes to the pituitary, that is we called about HPA axis. So when this hypothalamus secretes the hormonal system, goes to the capillary, and it stimulates other pituitary organs, other systems to have a normal endocrine functions. It also can happen here, or a normal set of neurons, what I discussed about this in neurochemical output. These are dendrites, axons, and the system, motor neurons. So the neuron is again through different types of neurons, including ganglion neurons like that, we can differentiate it. So as I said, if I want my chemical to release here, I need a stimulus. And the stimulus can be either through a small electrical current or ion exchange, or it can be of any neurotransmitter release. So depending upon this release pattern, what happens, my neurons will act like an excitatory or inhibitory action. That is called excitatory postsynaptic potential. Inhibitory postsynaptic potentiation. I need my neurons to get depolarization of the, is very much needed. So upon depolarization, what happens, the basic neural system will go on to higher side and go to the minus negative resting membrane potential to the positive side. And once the depolarization taken place, the impulse transmission get cleared off and comes back to the normal system. So this is a typical action potential recorded in 1939 by Hodgkin and Axley. And actually, they are the first group of scientists, those who are recorded in a big nervous system, big nerve. And where you can see, this is a zero. And this is a resting membrane potential, RMP. And this resting membrane potential is always negative, which clearly shows that the system, which is on the cellular system, inside the cell, is always on the negative side. And when I have a stimulus, and this stimulus, it can be either of a current or ion exchange or by neurochemical. And this stimulus makes my ion exchange takes place and goes to the positive side, plus 40. And once it's been depolarized, what happens? The cell function has to come back to its basic membrane. And then only I can go for the next stimulus like this, like a stimulus. Suppose if I have my drug, which can able to keep my cell function at depolarized conditions or at hyperpolarized condition, or I can prolong my refractory period, then what happens? The action potential will not develop, then automatically my neurochemical release will not be happening. So this is the basic fundamental for many cardiac drugs, adrenergic based drugs. These are all basic fundamental where we can see that the system will never, again, we can study about the prolongation of refractory period, or the depolarized condition. Simple example is lignokine. When I give lignokine, it opens the sodium channel and attaches the ligand, sodium, lignokine attaches it with the sodium binding packet inside the cellular membrane, and which allows more sodium in, automatically makes the cell system into a depolarized condition. So to make it negative to positive, there'll be a flush of sodium ions across the cell membrane with the fast sodium channel, followed by slow sodium channel. And this involves importance of ATPase enzyme. Without ATPase enzyme, this will never take place. And similarly, when I want to go for repolarization, I can use calcium, or there may be a for plaque response in cardiac muscle, or I can go with my small potassium ions where it comes out, it makes the cellular system into negative side. And this is the hyperpolarization responses, where we study about the barbiturates, benzodiazepines, this all come this segment. So once it has happened, then goes back to the normal. Then again, I can have an next stimulus like this, I keep on stimulate. So the nerve cells cannot be stimulated at any of these point at depolarized or hyperpolarized. When it is at resting membrane potential, I can trigger the responses. That is very, very fundamental. You should remember always. And this is a typical example I have shown it. You can see here, this is the presynaptic nerve terminal, and this is the postsynaptic nerve terminal. This is the calcium ion. You can have sodium, potassium, any ions. And you can see here, the influx of calcium or sodium ions generally makes, because it's adrenergic system, where we need calcium calmodulin responses to take place, And because of this calcium cholmodulin responses, the cell system will fuse it and releases the neurochemical and acts upon my ion and the receptors. It's a sodium channel linked ion channel. So I put the sodium channel is centering here. And when I have an action potential, you can see here it is at the plus 40. But the excitatory, you can see here it is never crossed negative side. There is a stimulus, but the threshold is not sufficient to produce any response. And you can see here the threshold level is increased and produces the responses. So that's the reason why it's excitatory, which has gone to the negative to the positive side. And if it crosses the minus 55, then only the stimulus peaks up. But until then, it is never takes up the signaling. That's why it is called excitatory postsynaptic, where I did not see any of the responses because it's only propagate the responses because the current fluctuation is not sufficient here. But here you can see it is a fluctuation is much on higher side where I can see the flux of ions. And because of the influx of ions, it gone to the action potential development, release of neurochemical and acts upon my postsynaptic system. This is a very basic. So unless otherwise you remember the current or the ion exchange or the stimulus, if does not reaches the threshold level, above threshold level, the response will not happen. It will only propagate. Suppose if I have inhibitory, what will happen? It goes to minus 90. Suppose if you take minus 70, it goes a little bit lower and goes like this. This is called inhibitory postsynaptic potential where I cannot see any stimulus at all. So as a fundamental, what we have seen so far is a neurotransmitter acts upon the present neurons. The chemical to state as a neurotransmitter, it should have the following five basic criteria. So we have insulin, but we never say it's in a neurochemical. It's only a hormone. Adrenaline, noradrenaline, why we say? Because it has its own proper synthetic pathway and specific to neurons. Suppose noradrenaline means adrenergic neurons. Serotonin means adrenergic neurons. It is specific to the neurons and is synthesized and stored in the vesicles before it releases. That is the second point. And this vesicle will come and fuse it by ionic exchange, ion difference. And this ionic difference fuses the vesicles with the cell membrane and releases the neuron upon stimulation. And this release neurotransmitter acts on postsynaptic receptors to produce specific pharmacological action. And upon this pharmacological action, if I have some other chemical, suppose for example, acetylcholine, I can use aricholine to produce the responses so that I can see mimic the action of my acetylcholine. Similarly, if I take noradrenaline, I can use either ephedrine. So it's indirectly acting, but still can act on my adrenergic receptor and produces similar responses, PRSAR type of responses. So any chemical synthesized, stored, released, acting, and mimic the action of any chemical which is there in the neuronal system, then those substances are called neurochemicals. So these neurochemicals are very important for my neuronal function. And this has been regulated by the nervous release. You can see here animated picture how it is happening. So this is a presynaptic neuron, this is a postsynaptic neuron. So these are the vesicles which is getting fused, released. And you can see here some of the red bullets, red balls going back. See, this is going back. And you can see some of the red balls going out of the synaptic cleft. You can see here. So some of the red balls, which are chemicals, which is coming in along with my, because it is getting stimulated. You can see here. The neurochemical will come and attach only on the postsynaptic receptor here. It will never go inside. But when neurochemical come and stimulates, it opens my channel and allows the ion to get in and propagate the responses. That is the way how the receptor acts. So no neurochemical will go inside the postsynaptic receptor. It stimulates the receptors. Upon stimulation, it propagates certain chemicals to go in and stimulates the GPCR mediated or ion channel or tyrosine kinase, any type of receptors stimulates and produces the response. That is very important. That means the neurochemical fuses, release, acts, goes back on presynaptic or pre-important. That means the neuron outside the synapse. Anything can happen. So these are the five different ways how my released chemicals will happen. And some chemicals will get metabolized and get cleared off from my system. So this is the way that we are going to play with the drugs. That means once my neurochemical is released, it is getting metabolized by specific enzymes like COMT or MAO inhibitors, ANP, something like that. Or it produces action through selective receptors. That means it acts in the selective receptors by blocking my, or by acting my postsynaptic level. Or can go to uptake 1 and 2. Uptake 1 is post-receptor mediated action, and uptake 2 is going back to my presynaptic system. And certain chemicals going outside the neuron, that is called extraneuronal uptake. I'll go back here. You can see this is release. This is uptake 1. Okay. After the uptake 1 goes back, this is uptake 2. That is presynaptic uptake. And this is postsynaptic uptake. And this is extraneuronal uptake. That means the neurotransmitter chemical can also go and act on my next set of neurons. It can be dopamine or acetylcholine itself, or can be other chemicals, other neuronal system, but can also can go and regulate it automatically, like dopamine or acetylcholine, regulating Parkinson's disease. The balancing is very much required. That is the way how the chemicals regulate one to the other system in the brain. Okay. Once if you understand this, then we can appreciate how these diseases can occur. So now we understood about the basic fundamental of neurochemistry, how these neurons are active, and how these neuronal transmitters are getting released, and what is uptake 1, uptake 2, extraneuronal uptake, and how these ion channels are very important for my action potential propagations, EPSP and IPSP. So we have seen everything in detail. And how these diseases are occurring. So if you take the brain system as a whole brain, the whole brain is not completely with, say, noradrenergic system or serotonergic system. It's not like that. So we have certain pockets, and these pockets are very much, concentrated with a set of neuronal system. Suppose if you take locus coeruleus, and this locus coeruleus in the brain, which is more focused on noradrenaline. So that segment is completely with noradrenergic system. Suppose if I disturb this locus coeruleus area of the midbrain, so what will happen? My adrenal system goes wrong. Then I don't have any chemical to control my presynaptic regulation of my chemical release. Suppose if you take raphe nucleus, a little bit below the, above the brainstem, so that's more of serotonergic system. And these serotonergic nerves goes to the different parts of my brain and regulates the other system. In striatum and basal ganglia, you can see dopamine. And hippocampus, dendritic gyrus, like a, we can see like a fish type, it will be there. You can see here in your the histological section. So where you can see the CA3 segment is also present, which is more of acetylcholine. Where you can see the cholinesterase transferase or the depth of neurons, their transfer, everything can observe it there. Hypothalamus is mainly concentrated with endorphins and encephalins, which is of OPI type of receptors. And there's again hypothalamus pituitary axis, HPA axis, where we can control the neuronal hormones. So the brain system is unique and focused with set of neurochemicals concentrated and which regulates the remaining set of the brain. That is the concept how we are focusing it on the disease. But suppose if we take Alzheimer's, we talk more about hippocampus. And we talk about cholinergic system. Next slide, I'll show the diseases. See, clinical conditions, neurotransmitters release modulations due to neurodegeneration observed. The best example is Parkinson's disease. When the striatal segment where we loss of dopaminergic neurons, and this loss of dopaminergic neurons aggravates cholinergic system, increases acetylcholine. And this acetylcholine regulation got lost because of acetylcholine more, it acts on my neuromuscular junction and produces muscular contraction, leads to rigidity, tremor, flaccid, all those things would happen here in Parkinson's disease. Suppose if you take epilepsy, where I have more excitatory responses and followed by inhibitory actions with the GABA receptors. So when I have more excitations, the presynaptic regulations come through GABA receptors, and where we use gabapentin as a drug of choice along with the ion channel blockers like phenytoin to block the epileptic action. If you take Alzheimer's, as I told, it's again symptomatic we talk about cholinergic system response along with serotonin. So if I have loss of serotonin, it can also leads to my Alzheimer's disease along with acetylcholine, it's interlinked. So depressions, there is no match of, because we know very clear this of noradrenaline and serotonin regulation, both. So what I emphasize here is, if I say one set of neuron, adrenaline, it is not adrenaline alone controlled by adrenaline alone. It is controlled by other neurochemicals also. That means as a regulatory mechanism, my neurons is specific to adrenergic system, fine. But still, my adrenergic neurons also get regulated by other neurochemicals, which are essential for my normal physiological functioning. If I lost one, another one will take an upper hand, automatically have end up with the disease. So I have to control this regulation of my neurons to a neurochemical release to get back my disease pattern into a normalized way. Like sleep, myasthenia gravis is the best example where we lost our cholinergic nervous system, but it's more periphery, but nothing to do with our neurochemical, but still easy for you to understand. I put myasthenia gravis also. And where we took with neostigmine as a test, and then we administered for more action of cholinergic system. Okay, where we get more muscles get relaxed. There is no, what to say, movements will be very much restricted. So these are some of the examples where we can see about the interlinking role of neurochemical regulation at the presynaptic level and disease progression. I'll show some of the nervous ending. Again, this is all taken from the book Fundamentals of Neuroscience book. You can see this is a myasthenia gravis. This is a myasthenia gravis patient condition. You can see here a complete, there'll be a proper vesicles and the release pattern is there, but you can see here the junction is completely lost.
Excuse me. Sir, the slide has not changed. I think it's on pathology and neurotransmitter slide. The examples that
now it is changed.
No, it. Yeah. Now it is okay. Yeah.
Okay. So you can see here. This is the normal cholinergic nervous system at the neuromuscular junction, and this is an acetylcholine receptors of nicotinic type NM type, and this is skeletal muscle. Okay. When I have a normal function, this acetylcholine will come and act and produces the response. But you can see here that the completely loss of my postsynaptic neurons, though I have acetylcholine, it cannot act here. Because of loss of acetylcholine, what will happen? The contraction response will blast it and become more relaxed. That is one type of problems where we administered or we go with the more cholinergic system activity. Suppose if you take here, this is another best example where you can see presynaptic regulation of alpha, presynaptic regulation of adrenergic system through alpha 2 receptors. So I have a chemical which is released, and as I said, there will be an reuptake, and this reuptake mechanism is an inhibitory mechanism at the cholinergic adrenergic system, and it's mediated through alpha 2 receptors. Suppose if I don't have much of adrenergic system, then what will happen? I can block this alpha 2 receptors where I can expect more of adrenergic system adrenaline release. And this adrenaline release will have my main, pharmacological action. The best example is ohimbin. The ohimbin type of drugs, which is automatically block my presynaptic alpha receptors. And this alpha receptor blockade inhibits my negative feedback mechanism. Inhibition of these feedback releases more of adrenaline, which acts on my postsynaptic receptors and produces adrenergic activities. That is a very simple example I can give you, where regulation of presynaptic receptors can promote into a therapeutic action or a pharmacological response, which again we studied in our third year pharmacology. And this is another example of serotonin, 5-HT, serotonin is reuptake, selective reuptake inhibitor, SSRI. And you can see here, serotonin channel, when I block this with my SSRIs, what will happen? There will be more active accountability of serotonin into my pharmacological action. I can this type of drugs are used for, say, for depression. So many times what we think is I have to work only on my postsynaptic receptors, tissue responses, and block it with an antagonist. But many times when I want to have more neuronal activation or more neuronal system activity, the most important or the best methodology is to regulate my presynaptic nerve. Thereby, I can enhance my neurotransmitter availability in the synaptic cleft or the synapse. Apart from this, I can also do my enzyme inhibition. But why enzyme inhibition is difficult is because it also can, suppose if we take asynchronous stress, we have enzyme inhibition, like neostigmine, physostigmine, dopaminergic type of drugs, because they are very specific. Suppose if you take COMT or MAO inhibitor, these are also common for all catecholamines, become non-specific. That's also one of the problems where we face it. So hence, people have tried in multiple ways, and one of the best methods they have found out is regulating the presynaptic receptors and its release of neurochemical, where we can expect more amount of neurochemical is available at the synapse for my postsynaptic potential and achieve my threshold level. So these are some of the examples which I want to emphasize about the regulatory mechanisms, how we can appreciate the importance of neurochemical neurons and its pharmacology in disease pattern. Okay. And these are some of the examples which I want to tell about this. Amitriptyline, both adrenergic and adrenaline, noradrenaline, and serotonin reuptake inhibitors. Then sertraline, it's again another SSRI type of group of drugs, fluoxetine. Yohimbine, already told you, alpha-2A. And if you remember this botulinum toxin and bisphenol, these are all we studied in the neurotransmitter regulations, and where we can, this is the toxins, very, very highly toxic substances. Even at the very, very picogram level, it's very toxic. To block the release of chemicals become very toxic. And I put channel blockers, they may not have any direct role in the release, but still, we study about potassium channel openers, sodium channel blockers, calcium channel blockers, chloride ion hyperpolarization responses by barbiturates and diazepams. So as a whole, my strong belief is, if you are very clear with this fundamentals of neurochemical release and role of ions and its regulatory mechanisms in any type of tissues and nervous system, the understanding pharmacology will become much, much easier. But many times we ignore this. And where you can easily understand the pharmacology much better way. Okay, so these are about my basic introduction and how the disease pattern involves in the drug. Then my last part of my talk is our research work, where we've taken about glutamate as a neurochemical and how we can regulate this neurochemical to achieve a significant effect in the ischemic condition. Okay, and it's a paper work published in Behavioral Pharmacology. So before starting, just I want to give about this glutamate. So glutamate is an excitatory amino acid, which we all very know, like aspartate, which is there in the zone of amino acid. And upon its release, it is mainly, we talked about epilepsy. If any student study about epilepsy means they talk about this excitatory responses of epilepsy. And also it plays an important role in stroke along with calcium ion, because when the brain is under, say, for example, ischemic condition means the stroke has happened, there is no blood supply to the particular area. And because of that no blood supply, what will happen? The cells are going to die. And because of that reason, complete inhibition, there will be a bounce back of my excitation because my cells think that I'm dying. So my glutamate receptors bounce back more of glutamate into the brain locality and try to produce excitation with the help of calcium. But unfortunately, that itself can become very dangerous at the later phase because of its signal transduction mechanism. That is one of the reasons why glutamate has been considered as a toxic chemical in the brain when it has been released at the higher dose. And this glutamate acts on glutamatergic receptors, and it acts to both metabotrophic as well as ionotrophic receptors. So this metabotrophic receptors mainly involve GPCR-mediated activity. And ionotrophic mainly with sodium, potassium, magnesium, zinc. It involves every substances, mainly for NMDA. In neurons, it is in the GLUT N2A and N2B type of classifications. I'm not going in detail about these GLUT N2A or N2B responses. And it also gets regulated by magnesium and have a specific role of inhibitory responses, because if you take memantine, which acts on my magnesium binding packet, and it produces a response. If you remember this mechanism of action, memantine. Okay. So I'll talk about these part, glutamate N2A and N2B. I'm not going in detail because it involves more of molecular pharmacology. So it might be out of the scope of this particular talk. Okay, so if you take cerebral ischemia, I told already this increased release of glutamate and calcium takes place. And this glutamate release, if you think it up in my first slides, I talked about the astrocytes. And these astrocytes come to the rescue by taking the least excess glutamate by transporter system, executive amino acid transporter system. So glutamate is released in excess. So the excess release of glutamate has to be removed from my brain to minimize the toxicity. And for that, astrocytes come into the picture. And these astrocytes will take away all my excitatory amino acid by glutamate transporter system, that is excitatory amino acid transporter system 2. And this astrocytes also responsible for synthesis of glutathione, and also releases to minimize my radical generations. The second defense mechanism you can see here. That means when I have excitation, loss of hypoxia, in the hypoxia status, more amount of reactive oxygen species get released. And because of that, there'll be a oxidative stress, and glutathione come into picture to regulate my oxyradicals generations. And if you take, it has been regulated by NMDA receptors, memantine has been used one of the drug of choice for this. And our thing is whether we can control the release of glutamate can be neuroprotective. And how to prevent this release of glutamate from the nerve terminal. So these two are our concern. So we thought whether we can control the glutamate release. If it is controlled, whether it can have any neuroprotective actions or not. Okay. So before that, just I want to tell about the neurotransmission of glutamate receptor, just in a very nutshell. So this is a glutamate. And the glutamate is a non-NMDA receptor mediator response. When it enters the glutamate, it opens ion channels and produces the action. Suppose we are concerned with the NMDA receptor mediated action, where you can see it can bind with the glutamate, glycine, and also related by magnesium, sodium, calcium, and phencyclidine. And this is a magnesium binding packet is the place where memantine is going to sit and produces the action, inhibitory action. Okay. So now what we thought is, why can't we hyperpolarize with the glutamate itself? That means when I have a stimulation of my receptors here, need not prevent the release, I can have more amount, low amount of sodium always being present inside the brain system, where I can prevent the excitatory response. That is our hypothesis. Okay. And other thing is metabotrophic glutamate receptors. As I said, it's another receptors, it acts upon and mediates GPC or mediated responses, phospholipase C and ionosterol phosphate, diacylglycerol, then produces signal transduction. This is ionotrophic mechanism, this is a metabotrophic receptors. So we are concerned with only the ionotrophic receptors, that we are going to infuse low sodium of glutamate and see how it happens, the how it produces the response. This is about the glutamine 2A and 2B. This is, I'm not going in detail, where you can see here in the neurons, the chemical release will act upon this, any one of these chemicals. And now we are exploring on these two receptors further in our research currently. So with this background and pathology of hypothesis, pathology of ischemia, we started our work with the hypothesis, slow infusion of low dose of glutamate in brain during ischemic condition might be neuroprotective to the control of release of glutamate from the neurons. The selected dose for the study will not produce any defined pharmacological action. That is one of the important parameters. So any dose, for the dose which we are selected, will not produce any pharmacological action, means we cannot see any physical responses or functional changes happening in the animal. Suppose if you take monosodium glutamate at 2 gram, the animal will show all its excitations and also produce all toxicity. But when you use this very, very low dose, it is a very slow infusion, which is a system, thereby it will never allow the and the hyperpolarized state will never allow the neurons to get excited, and thereby can prevent my release of glutamate and control the ischemic condition. Okay. Sorry. So I use we have used male mice with 25 to 30 grams with 6 months of age, and ischemic effect induced by bilateral common carotid occlusion, and drug has been treated with 3 days, 30 minutes before the treatment, 30 days before, 30 minutes before the ischemic induction, and on day 1, 2, and 3, so we given the slow infusion of glutamate, and we estimated again glutamate, GABA, ATP, nitric oxides, and other radical changes. Also, we used laser Doppler image for cerebral blood flow measurement, because there is a direct evidence to show that there is a decrease in blood supply because of the bilateral common carotid occlusion in the brain. And when we do the treatment, whether the blood flow has been retained or not, that is a direct evidence to show it. And also, we measured the functional recovery, like with using a rotor rod and adaptive behavior or muscle coordinations, like grip strength. And that is another indication to show that the muscular coordination has not been affected and with the treatment. So this is a functional recovery and direct evidence along with the biochemical changes. So these three we are taken as a basic fundamental parameters to link whether the low sodium glutamate infusion can produce any significant effect on ischemic status or not. Okay. And you can see here, micromoles per kilogram root so infusion, and amphetamine, which is a NMDA receptor inotropic magnesium binding packet at 20 milligram, we administer through similar way by IP root. And once has been over, after the third day, we collected the cortex, hippocampus, and striatum for our biochemical estimations, and we also recorded the mortality of the animals when we did the experiment. At the end of the experiment, the mice were sacrificed and tissue was harvested for the biochemical estimations. And you can see here the images of the mouse brain. It's a laser Doppler images of MOOC. And you can see here, this is a sham operator where we just opened the skin and we did the sutures, no occlusion. So 0 hour, 24 hours, 48 and 72 hours. Both the hemisphere, you can see there is a blood flow, proper blood flow is there. And this is an ischemic reperfusion image. And you can see here, as the days progress, you can see there's a complete or very, very minimal blood supply. And L, that is L-glutamic acid infusion, is trying to restore it. And memantine, it is also restored it. So when compared to this, definitely the slow infusion have restored the blood supply at the frontal segment of the brain. And when we see here, memantine is able to restore it almost the best, better way. And if you measure the glutamate level, if you see the glutamate and GABA, this is a glutamate and GABA, some nanomoles per gram tissue. I have taken only the hippocampal segment. I have not taken other segment because of the space constraint. And see here, control, it is around two nanomoles. But in ischemic damage, you can see here, it's keep on bouncing back higher and higher up to 10 micromoles, 10 nanomoles. But the infusion, you can see here, this completely decrease. Our major hypothesis is whether it can inhibit the release. So presynaptically, because I said there is no pharmacological response, that itself clearly shows that the drug is not acting through postsynaptic mechanisms, only on a presynaptic mechanism. On presynaptically, when I occupy my glutamate receptors with the glutamate, what happens, there will be a drastic decrease in the glutamate release up to 30 or 72 hours. But its memantine is less, but not been so less, but it has been significantly reduced. Similarly, if you take GABA, as I said, when I have an excitations, automatically it bounces back to compensate my loss of excitatory response, or to minimize the excitatory response, I have more inhibitory chemical release also been observed. So this is one of the basic observations which we published in 2012 as GABA as a defense neurochemical when there is an excitations, and you can see here, it is never come back. Even I got back my glutamate around 3, but still you can see here it is on the higher side. But still brain wants to have more and more release of GABA to protect my neurons. That is a self-defense mechanism. Without any treatment, just we have given leftover. So GABA itself is having bounce back to have this. That's the reason why sometimes you can see here when the patient affected with epilepsy, they fall in sleep because of more release of this GABA receptors, it may be. And same way here, you can see memantine treated, where you can see a higher level of GABA bounce back. So it clearly shows that glutamate and GABA receptors, regulatory mechanisms are interlinked. And when there is a glutamate excess release, GABA bounce back and there'll be an excess of release. And when I occupy my presynaptic receptor of glutamate, there'll be a decrease in glutamate release in the brain. That clearly shows that thus glutamate can be one of the important substances can be used for it. And you can see here, there is a complete functional recovery of my brain system and the ischemic damage has been completely recovered without much of problem. So as a result and observations, slow infusion of glutamate and not produce excited toxicity and restore the behavioral function. That is one of our major observations, which has been appreciated by the editors also. And it increased the cerebral blood flow after ischemic damage and protected the brain. That is very important because we are also shown physiologically as well as the evidence, when I have a slow infusion of glutamate, blood flow has been maintained and glutamate level is decreased and GABA is bounced back. And the simple mechanism, what I want to say is, so when I have a glutamate release, extra glutamate will not come and attach my substances. And once it has been attached, there'll be complete block of this area and where the glutamate release cannot happen. So as a mechanism, what we proposed in the study is glutamate release is associated with calcium, that also we have proven it. And depolarization of calcium mediated excitotoxicity of vesicles of glutamate release. This has been failed because of our glutamate activity and resulting in decrease in glutamate release and neuroprotection's effect of L-glutamic acid through autoregulation has been observed. And this is one of the major observations which leads to further exploration of this further neuro-2A and 2B receptors and how it can have any significant role in glutamate mediated toxicity. And also we have proposed this can be explored because we don't know in clinical situations at what level there'll be extra glutamate release, whether sometimes some may pick up this work as a at a preclinical level where low infusion of glutamate might inhibit the ischemic damages. Okay. So this work is completely supported by two of my students, Mr. Abdul Kaim and Dr. Justin. So they have contributed this work. And we have also published in Behavioral Pharmacology. So I won't acknowledge them at this moment. Okay, as a concluding remarks, so neurons and neurotransmitters are a wonderful, I love it. So it play an vital role in disease progression. So exploring the neuronal function and neurotransmitter release, it can be a good target that one can explore it properly. And electrophysiology is an important component nowadays coming in the clinical side also. And once if we explore it properly, definitely it has some therapeutic significance in many non-infectious diseases, especially CNS-related diseases. Okay. So with this, I will conclude my talk. I thank the organizers again, and I'm happy to answer any questions. And I hope I have reached you all with my around 45 minutes or 50 minutes of talk. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. It was really a very, very thought-provoking session. I think some of the key points, like you dealt with the basics of neurotransmitters and the pathophysiology of it. Also, some therapeutic applications of neurotransmitter regulation in ischemia, especially. So we have one question from a participant. Can artificial neuron generation help in ischemia? So in the treatment of ischemia. So
I am not aware of it, but people are now working on neurogenesis. Okay. So they try to produce by with chemicals which can able to regenerate the neurons. That approach has come already. Suppose if it is so successful, then definitely it will help in Alzheimer's disease.
Okay.
So I'm not very sure of that, but definitely by.
Okay.
Okay. Okay then. Any other questions?
We have only one question. So that okay, was the
thanks,
only question.
Thanks a lot.
I think it was really a remarkable session, sir. We had many insights. I think even the students would have got insights about the basics of neurotransmitters, as well as people in research would also be benefited with certain tips that can be used in getting the study done at a faster rate. So I think you have dealt both with the students as well as the faculty in a very, very concise manner. So I would just like to say that neurotransmitters, just summarizing your session, neurotransmitters play a critical role in neural communication, which influences everything, right from involuntary movements up to the learning part. So the system is both complex and highly interconnected. So that's what we understood from your session. And
definitely. That's the reason why nobody comes to this area. Understand. Where it goes, how it goes, how it acts, why it is so complicated. One act controls five. So that's one of the toughest area to understand. Yeah,
exactly. So I think we can just conclude saying that they act in specific ways, but they can also affect many diseases, drugs, and even the actions of many chemical messengers as well. So as a whole, the human era, it is just living on neurotransmitters, just chemicals. So...
just remember Avatar. Just remember Avatar.
Yeah, definitely. Yes. Yeah. So, okay. Yeah, I think we would like to, on behalf of Abhaypa and IPA, I would like to just thank you for your valuable session, sir. And I would also like to thank Dr. Vishwanath, sir, our honorable chairman, for giving such a wonderful speaker and a resource person to us. Also, I would like to thank Suchitra Madam for coordinating this event and also organizing this. I would also like to thank Deepthi Madam, who is behind the screen helping out in admitting the participants. So also, I also thank all the IT staff who have helped me in getting this done, the Zoom meeting. So overall, I would like to thank all the participants for not only just attending it, but also participating in it in a better way. So thank you so much, sir, for your
valuable... Thanks a lot. Yeah, I leave the meeting. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Can we end the session, sir?
Yeah, please. Sure.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. And for all the participants, just find your feedback form. The link is given here. I'll just end the session once. It will be on for 2 minutes. You can just copy the, just click on the feedback form. You'll get the certificates later.
Mm-hmm.